You're listening to the BBM Global Network with 25 years in broadcast audio and video production. Our passionate team creates content and marketing for the world of Internet talk radio. If you've got a passion, come join us at bbmglobalnetwork.com. The BBM Global Network. Your voice is now heard.
I can feel your presence, I can feel your loving power in the gift of this communion, in this holy hour. Jesus, will you heal me of my iniquity? This I ask of you, 'cause I believe. I believe, I believe in you. I know the story is true.
Please welcome the host of Dr. T, PhD, Dr. Hilaire Taverner.
And I can feel the Holy Spirit now, 'cause I believe.
Welcome, everyone. I'm your host, Dr. Hilaire Taverner, and you are listening to Dr. T, PhD, and we are coming live on BBM Global Network Radio and Network and TuneIn Radio. And also, always, I'd like to thank Paul Kolesky for allowing me to use his song, I believe. It's absolutely one of my favorites. It speaks to my soul. It goes on for 5 minutes, but we only use the first minute. But we'll also conclude our program with the thoughts of I Believe. I also always like to begin with a prayer. So if you can join me in a collective gathering of thought. Christ said, where there's two or three gathered in his holy name, that he would be in our midst. And there's two or three or more gathered right now in this very moment. And I ask Almighty God, wherever there is a way, a venue, a street, a path, to save those babies from being slaughtered and murdered. They've done nothing wrong. They're the innocents of innocence. And our Constitution promises all the rights to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. I don't remember the part where it says, unless you're a defenseless, innocent child growing in your mother's womb. So tonight's program is, as you know, God, such a passionate passionate program for me, and I'm so grateful. And I ask you, please, to bestow your grace upon every soul in this nation, enlighten them, open their minds from this ignorance and this untruth. Every child is precious to God. And I also ask you to bless and bestow your grace upon every clergy and every man and woman who stands up right to defend and fight for the rights of the unborn. And I ask you, Almighty God, to bless Father Frank Pavone for being so gracious to join us and lead us in this particular program. We bless you, we honor you, we give you thanks, and we pray all of this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm also just want to quickly kind of tell you before I introduce Father, is that next week, I hope you tune in, we're going to have a friend of mine. She's going to talk about the blessings of handwritten correspondence, you know, instead of just sending a little text or an email, but to sit down with your own hand and compose your thoughts and send it to a friend when there's a death, when there's just the journey of, you know, that you want to share with someone. It's going to be a wonderful program. And the week after that, we have a priest from Ireland, Father McGinnity, and he's going to talk about Christine Gallagher. Gallagher, who is a visionary over in Ireland, and that's going to be tricky because I've never had a guest from Ireland. So hopefully that will all work well. At this time, I want to introduce and welcome a man I have profound respect for. This is Father Frank Pavone. He's calling from Florida. And Father Frank, I do believe you are there with us, correct, down in Florida?
Hi, Dr. T. Yes, I am. Good to be on your program.
Oh, great to have you. I'm up here in Ohio, and we are both connected to New York City and then around the world on the internet. And, Oh, gosh, I'm so happy you're with us. Could you just do me the favor? I always like the speaker to pretty much introduce themselves. Tell us a little bit about you so we know who you are, sir, please.
Sure, absolutely. Well, I am a Catholic priest, but I've devoted my whole life and ministry to protecting children in the womb from the violence of abortion. And I've been involved in the pro-life movement since my high school days. I grew up in New York, just a little bit north of New York City, and got involved in this cause, as I say, in high school. And it was at the same time that I felt the call to ministry. I was assigned, once I was ordained, to a parish in New York City. But then, after a few years in the parish, I came to the conviction that I wanted to devote all my time, all my energy, all my work to the unborn and protecting these children from the greatest human rights violation of our times, which is abortion. And I was given permission to do that, and I've been doing it ever since. That was in 1993 that I began leading this this organization called Priests for Life, although it's not just for priests and it's not just for Catholics. It's for anyone and everyone who wants to do something to end abortion. And that's our website is endabortion.us. And we work with everybody. We do a lot of educational work, broadcasting as we're doing tonight, traveling, speaking, writing. Meeting with legislators, meeting with bringing pro-life groups together and meeting with them to construct strategies and projects, all the different things that the pro-life movement does, including a very important thing we do, too, is the healing of those that have had abortions. There's so many wounds, and we have the world's largest program for healing those wounds. So that's, in a nutshell, a lot of what we're about here at Priests for Life.
I've heard that you're the president now going, is it on 26 years then, that you've been the president for Priests for Life. Is that correct?
That's exactly correct, yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. Congratulations. You've had a powerful ministry. You know, I'm going to ask
you
a question. I'm going to ask you a question that you're probably not expecting, and it's only for clarification. The late-term abortion, is there a specific date? What is the definition of a late-term abortion? I don't know.
Yeah, it's not specifically a medical term, so there's not a fixed definition with medical precision. A lot of times people will speak about late-term abortions as being anything after the first trimester because, and many people believe that abortions only occur in the first trimester, first 12 weeks, but no, they're legal and they occur in all of the months of pregnancy. A lot of times people will think of late-term abortion as happening after 20 weeks. That's a dividing line for some, and then others will think of it in terms of babies who are viable. And, of course, the age of viability is going lower and lower with each passing year.
Yes.
But basically we're talking about the last, the last half of pregnancy, you could say, is certainly late-term abortion.
Okay, thank you. Now, is this a unique time in the United States when everyone seems to be talking about late-term abortions?
You know, it is. We have always been convinced, we at Priests for Life, I personally, that focusing in on the abortions that occur in the later stages of pregnancy is the key to restoring protection to all the unborn children at every stage. And it's because it's the most disturbing thing. It's the thing that gets people's attention. And we saw this phenomenon at various points in our history so far here in America with the pro-life movement. We saw this happen back in the mid-90s. A medical paper had come out in the early 90s about a procedure that actually aborted the baby while the baby was in the birth canal. And that came to be known as partial birth abortion. And if you recall, at that time, it caused a big public stir. Congress voted several times to prohibit this procedure. President Clinton vetoed the bill twice. It finally got signed into law by President George W. Bush. It was upheld by the Supreme Court. And so now we're in another moment like that, which we'll talk about after our break, where more renewed attention is being focused on these late-term abortions.
I look forward to hearing more about this. And my God bless you, our listeners. We're going to take about a two-minute break. And I'm your host, Dr. Hilaire Taverner. You're listening to Dr. T, PhD. Stay with us. We have a profound program this evening. You need to know these things. God bless.
French Rastafarian baker Chef Hugues Mott is a fourth-generation baker and has worked in 11 countries across three continents. Born in Mulhouse, France, he began apprenticing in his father's bakery at age 12 and has devoted his life to learning cultures of the world from inside kitchens across the globe. He also teaches traditional French baking by hosting demonstrations and classes, and his passion for baking is reflected in his delicious confections. With a deep respect for discipline and his Rastafarian way of life, Chef Hugues Mott exemplifies commitment to tradition and culture in a global world. Traveling extensively and combining a myriad of flavors into his recipes, Chef Hugues Mott brings a unique approach to baking. To read more about the French Rastafarian baker, visit www.frenchchefhugues.com. That's H-U-G-U-E-S. Bon appetit and bless up.
Attorney Renee Marie Smith is changing the way we sell real estate. She wrote a series of books called My Short Sale Guru Guides for all real estate practitioners. Whether you're a homeowner wanting to understand the process, an agent who has been handling short sales for years, or an industry analyst wanting to know how short sales impact your business, Renee uses her vast real estate experience to take a comprehensive look at the recent market phenomena while relaying it in an easy-to-understand format. Through her company, Smith Title Services, Renee has counseled thousands of short sale participants and processed in excess of 1,000 short sales. Her knowledge is transformational for real estate professionals and laymen alike, and her live presentations provide people the opportunity to ask specific questions about their issues. Buy her books and schedule her to speak at your next event. Visit www.smithtitleservices.com or call 305-705-3428 or email her at renee@smithtitleservices.com. Isn't it time to sell your property today? Learn the My Short Sale Guru way.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm Dr. Hilaire Taverner. You're listening to Dr. T, PhD, and we are coming to you live on BBM Global Network. Our guest tonight is Father Frank Pavone. He's going to teach us about one of the most profound and problematic and painful situations in our nation at this time, and that is the abortion of the unborn child. Father Frank, may I ask you, you want to continue your thought, or do you want me to like ask you something different? What's your pleasure?
Well, just to continue on what we were saying, it's a very important question that you asked. And yes, we are at a pivotal moment right now because more attention has been brought to the fact that abortions occur in the latest stages of pregnancy. A lot of people were not aware that that was already happening because that policy was ushered in back 46 years ago with the Roe versus Wade decision. That actually allowed abortion throughout pregnancy. But it came to light more recently when the state of New York passed the new law, even expanding the already wide open access to abortion and making it clear that right up to the very day of birth, this could be done. And then other states began to introduce it. And then it became clear that the protections were being taken away from babies even after they're born, because sometimes a baby will survive a late term abortion procedure and they're killing them anyway. And so now people are in a real uproar about this. And we're kind of looking at this and saying, hey, folks, we've been trying to tell you this for decades, but we're glad that finally now people are realizing that this is really happening. And they're realizing that it has to stop.
You know, I'm going to say something that you're not responsible for, but I just am like the governor or the mayor of New York City. What's his name again?
Oh, the governor Cuomo.
Okay, Cuomo. I understand he's a Catholic, but my question is, how can I call myself a Catholic and believing the murder of children? I would never call myself a Catholic. I wouldn't claim to be a Catholic.
You shouldn't even claim to be a decent human being. I mean, these people are People like Cuomo and so many others who are in public office, and they are in favor of destroying these babies. I mean, they are literally making this happen. He literally signed a law, the result of which is to take the lives of more children. And not only does this contradict the Catholic faith, it contradicts the Christian gospel, it contradicts the meaning of public service, because a public servant is supposed to know the difference between serving the public and killing the public. And if he doesn't, he doesn't belong in public office. And then, of course, it contradicts just basic human decency and the principles of America and the principles of civilization. So it contradicts a lot of things. But it really is offensive when these people stand up and say, oh, yes, I'm a Catholic.
Yeah, and it bothers me. And let's say the big one, of course, is the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not kill.
Right.
How can we just disregard that one? I mean, when we break the commandments that God gave us, you know, I just that's a mortal, a grievous offense, really.
And we should point out that it's not the abortionists do not deny that this is, in fact, an act of killing. Now, of course, abortionists differ one from another, but if people think that they're going ahead doing this because they don't believe it's killing, that's not true. You can see abortionists saying publicly that, oh, yes, we know that we're killing a child, we're killing a human being, but they believe that there's justification for that when the mother's choice demands it. So this is really, I mean, thou shalt not kill, it applies pretty directly and forcefully to this issue.
Oh, God, yes. Now, I want to also, like, just to keep you helping us, I know that the different states are having different decisions. New York State, when I saw that vote, I was so appalled, I could hardly believe it. And then, of course, Virginia, yeah, by, I think, one vote, they could have gone on board with that monstrous law as well. But what's the national news regarding which states, what's going on? I know the whole nation seems, there's a lot going on, I understand.
There is. There is no federal law that would prohibit abortions until birth. This is the critical thing people need to understand. When Roe versus Wade was handed down in 1973, it eliminated all the protections for the unborn. Now, it did say that an individual state could, if it wanted to, but it didn't have to, protect babies in the 7th, 8th, and 9th months of pregnancy. And a number of states have such laws, and about 20 other states have introduced laws now to protect babies from 20 weeks forward. That's a new law that's coming about because of the fact that these babies now, we know, can feel pain. The states are saying, well, you know, we have laws protecting cattle from pain when they're slaughtered for our food. We can at least protect human children from pain. But it's a checkerboard because some states are continuing to move in that direction of giving more protection to these babies. And other states, like you mentioned, New York, Virginia, it's also happening in Vermont, Rhode Island, New Mexico, Massachusetts. Various states are introducing these laws. It's a checkerboard picture because it all depends. Really, it boils down to one thing: which party is in control of the state legislature? Because you'll see that all these pushes for late-term abortion and even for removing protection from the babies after they're born are being pushed by Democratic lawmakers. All the pushes for the pro-life laws and extending the protections for the unborn are being pushed by Republican lawmakers. Now, that's just the fact of the situation. That's not even a political statement. That's just laying out the facts of what's happening in these various states. And it leads to the question, of course, what is it about being a member of the Democratic Party that makes these lawmakers feel like they have to push for unlimited abortion? It's a strange, strange thing because, you know, no political party should be defined by that. It's a sad thing when that happens.
Wow. Well, you know, I'm so intent, but it's time for us to take another break, Father. So
yes.
I'm going to ask everyone to please join us. We'll be back in 2 minutes. Father Frank Pavone is with us and teaching us some very important thing. So please return. We need you. God bless.
MJ Domet is the owner of Expect to Be Empowered, a company whose specialty is empowering people to live their best life by following their heart and accepting themselves unconditionally. After studying and making personal changes, MJ now focuses on giving others tools for self-empowerment. She provides individual and group workshops for people who are physically, emotionally, and spiritually blocked. Inspired by her work at Expect to Be Empowered, MJ authored the book Waves of Blue Light, Heal the Heart and Free the Soul, with accompanying empowerment cards. She is a Spirit Book of the Year Gold Medal Living Now Book Award winner. And her book is a number one Amazon bestseller in spirituality and was a 2012 Gold Medal winner, recognized as the Living Now Spirit Book of the Year. An inspirational speaker, MJ will show you how you can repurpose every area of your life. Your life did not just happen to you. You chose it, which means you can change it. Visit www.expecttobeempowered.com or call 866-264-8024.
WikiWags brings harmony back into your home for male dogs and their owners. Inventor and entrepreneur Linda Jangula has created the disposable doggy diaper wraps made with the male dog in mind. The built-in wicking ability prevents rashing and other potential health issues for your dog. Each wrap comes in four sizes and has dual reattachable magic tabs for easy adjustments. And each size has a 7-inch logo strip for adjustability, so they are comfortable and easy to use. No more fuss, just leave the mess to us. Whether you're in or out, your dog will be free to run about. Stop cleaning and start enjoying your home, and you can even leave your dog alone. To order your WikiWags, visit WikiWags.com, or to find out where to buy WikiWags in your town, visit MyWikiWags.com and start enjoying having man's best friend around.
Welcome back, everyone. We're so glad you're still with us. I'm Dr. Taverner, and you're listening to Dr. T, PhD, and Father Frank Pavone, who's really talking about a lot of important issues in our nation. And, of course, America affects the world, so what goes on here does affect the world. Let's not think for a moment that it doesn't. But, Father Frank, I was just about to share with you when we needed to take a break that the state of Ohio, we had a Governor Kasich who was a Republican, but he was not in favor of the protection of the unborn. Very disappointing. You know, the Senate and the House in Ohio both voted to protect them with the heartbeat bill, that the child would be, as soon as you hear a heartbeat, that child may not be murdered. And he vetoed it, and there wasn't enough to overcome. But we have a new governor now, Mike DeWine, and he's made it very clear that if the House and the Senate will bring that bill back, he will absolutely pass it. And I would be so delighted, and I'm praying for that every single day. But are there any other hopeful signs in the states? Do you know of any other good news?
Oh, there's a lot going on in the states that's positive. You know, we see all, for example, even in the midterm elections, in West Virginia and also in Alabama, there were actually referenda on the ballot asking people to amend the state constitution to provide more protections for the unborn and to indicate that funding of abortion, a lot of these battles revolve around funding, was not something that the state constitution required, because a lot of times the pro-abortion forces will try to use that as an argument. Oh, our constitution, you know, requires funding of abortion, et cetera. And those, both of those ballot initiatives won.
Wonderful.
That was marvelous. They both won. Now, in a number of other states, now this heartbeat legislation that you just mentioned, that Ohio really has been the leader of this effort with the heartbeat bills. A number of other states are considering those as well. In fact, I want to recommend to our listeners a good resource if they really want to probe into the state laws that are in effect in every state, including their own, and also talk about the opportunities for state legislation. There is a book called Defending Life that is put out each year by Americans United for Life, one of the key pro-life groups. We work with them very closely. And at the website aul.org, AUL for Americans United for Life, they'll be able to download download free of charge this book called Defending Life 2019. It's issued every year. It's updated with the good news and the bad news about where each state stands in terms of laws regarding abortion and the unborn child. I really recommend people have that as a resource because, they can see what's going on in their own state, and they can also get an idea of what kinds of state legislation are advancing, such as the ones I mentioned already, the 20-week law that would protect babies from 20 weeks of pregnancy. There's another one that has been passed in about a dozen states and is underway in a few more, which protects babies from any abortion procedure that involves dismemberment. Now, this is when you get into the second trimester, you've got a lot of these procedures that literally tear the baby apart limb from limb. And we say dismemberment, and it's not a term that we're making up. This is the word that is used in the premier medical textbook on how to do abortions. It's called Abortion Practice by abortionist Warren Hearn. And this book uses two words to describe these abortion procedures that should make people's jaws drop. The two words are dismember and decapitate. And this is what's being done to these babies legally in these procedures that some people like to talk about. Oh, it's freedom, it's choice, it's reproductive health. You know, Dr. T, I've noticed something very, very significant, that any time one of these legislators who supports abortion speaks about it, they never use those kinds of words that actually describe what an abortion is. You'll never hear them say dismember, decapitate, arms, legs, skull, crush the skull. They'll never talk about those things. But those are the words that are in the medical textbooks. Instead, what you'll hear them talk about is freedom, choice, reproductive rights, women's health. You know, well, who's against those things? We're all in favor of those things. But we're not in favor of killing babies. So the abortion supporters need to be honest about what they're supporting, and that's one of the things we should all challenge them to do. It's like, if you're going to go out there and say this is okay, at least you could have the integrity to tell us what you're talking about. But they don't even want to admit what it is that they're talking about, because they know when the American people hear it, they are aghast and they are rejecting it, and that's what's happening more and more.
One of the things that infuriates me as a taxpayer, that my taxes go to the murdering of children. I'm just like,
isn't that terrible?
What about my rights? I don't want to support the murdering of babies. I find that appalling. You know,
it is appalling. And thank God, you know, this is one of the areas where President Trump has been doing a lot of good, because there are certain funding channels that are under the control of the executive branch. Some of the funding channels can only be turned off by Congress. The president is willing to sign the legislation that would defund the abortion industry. But he has taken executive action up until even very recently, in these recent days, actually. He fortified a rule that says that the Title X family planning funds that go to low-income citizens for health care are not in any way to be involved with supporting abortion. And he's protecting our tax money. I mean, if people wanted their money to go to the abortion industry, hey, they can donate to Planned Parenthood, you know? I mean, but if we don't want it to go for that, why should we be forced to cooperate in something that's evil? So a lot of people believe exactly like you just said, even people who call themselves pro-choice. You know, it's one thing to say, oh, they believe that a woman should have the choice to have an abortion. It's another thing to say, I ought to be required to pay for it. Those are two very different things.
Exactly, because it makes me an accomplice. If I'm paying that's just, what about my rights? And the other thing is, you know, I know when a pregnant woman is in a car accident and she and her baby is killed, it's called a double homicide. You know, we talk out of both sides of our mouth. And the other thing I'm getting a little bit upset. I'm sorry. Right.
You know, it's good to be getting upset about these things. The tragedy here is that so many people are not upset by it. So many people are acting as if there is no problem at all, or the problem is less serious than it is. We need to start getting upset. We need to start getting angry. And then we need to take that energy that comes from that and direct it towards the good things we can all do to restore protection to these children.
Right. I mean, women are in charge of their own bodies. Men are in charge of theirs. But the problem is, that's not my body. I'm not cutting off my arm or my leg. I'm destroying and murdering another person. People don't understand. That's another person.
Exactly. Different blood type, different genetic code.
Absolutely. What do you think of the Democratic candidates for presidency? Whoa, guess what? I'm looking at my watch. It's already time for us to take another break. I'm telling you, Father Frank Pavone, this program is probably going faster than any I've ever had. So I'm going to ask you all to join us in 2 minutes. We'll be back. I'm Dr. T, and you're listening to Dr. T, PhD. Don't leave us.
French Rastafarian baker Chef Hugues Mott is a fourth-generation baker and has worked in 11 countries across 3 continents. Born in Mulhouse, France, he began apprenticing in his father's bakery at age 12 and has devoted his life to learning cultures of the world from inside kitchens across the globe. He also teaches traditional French baking by hosting demonstrations and classes, and his passion for baking is reflected in his delicious confections. With a deep respect for discipline and his Rastafarian way of life, Chef Hugues Mott exemplifies commitment to tradition and culture in a global world. Traveling extensively and combining a myriad of flavors into his recipes, Chef Hugues Mott brings a unique approach to baking. To read more about the French Rastafarian baker, visit www.frenchchefhugues.com. That's H-U-G-U-E-S. Bon appetit and bless up. Animal lover, author, artist, and public speaker, Patricia Daly Leip is a Renaissance woman in her own right. A lover of animals from a young age, Patricia lives on a farm in Virginia and has rescued neglected thoroughbred horses, keeping them or finding them safe havens. She is also a published author, and her books document real-life experiences that she shares in her passionate stories, taking the reader around the world in a colorful kaleidoscope of life. An accomplished artist, Patricia Daly Leip's oil paintings feature animals, portraits, stills, nature, and abstract, and she allows the brush to paint the image in an organic, natural way. A public speaker, Patricia is motivated to continually wonder about life and advocates for all of us to do the same and document our own unique history. To learn more about Patricia Daly Leip, visit www.literarylady.com and www.patricialeip.com or email her at pdleip@gmail.com.
Welcome back, everyone. As you know, I'm Dr. Hilaire Taverner. You're listening to Dr. T, PhD on BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. And we also have our guest speaker tonight is Father Frank Pavone, a man that I've read and known and learned about. He has been so involved and so engaged in this cause. And I just have questions for him. This is so much fun for me. It's the first time I've ever spoken with this man, even though I've seen him on television nationally and I've read about him. And I'm very well knowledgeable about the hard and most important work that he's doing. Father Frank, what do you think of the outlook for the decision of the Supreme Court? Do you think they will ever overturn Roe versus Wade, in your opinion?
Well, Dr. T, I want to say that yes, that not only will the court reverse Roe versus Wade, but I believe it will happen sooner than most people think. Let's give a couple of reasons for that. You know, first of all, the court has already very severely weakened Roe versus Wade, although it has, in multiple subsequent decisions, reaffirmed the central holding of Roe v. Wade, which is that, okay, a person can get an abortion in this country and no one can stop her from doing that. But the court has changed the framework that Roe versus Wade initially set out, and it's given the states a lot more leeway to set the conditions under which abortions can be done, like we were talking about before, a lot of these state laws. In the last few years, there have been literally hundreds of state laws, pro-life laws, that have been passed and upheld. That, of course, just as a parenthesis, makes us realize that when states like New York jump in and they do these radical pro-abortion laws, they're sort of newcomers to the game of state legislation, because the pro-abortion people usually go to the courts to get their way, you know, so that they find their liberal judges and impose their will on the rest of the people and bypass the elected representatives. But when you look at the states, I mean, there have been so many laws passed for pro-life, and this in itself is a weakening of Roe v. Wade. But now, the circumstances are so different now than they were in 1973. We know much more about who the unborn child is. Roe v. Wade says, well, we're not sure when human life begins. We're not sure. Well, we are sure now. We know more about the unborn child now than we ever did in human history. So that circumstance has changed. And the court can look at that evidence again. In fact, one of the district courts upheld a law in South Dakota that actually requires the abortionist to tell the mother before the procedure that the abortion procedure is going to, and these are the, this is the, exactly the words that the law says he has to tell her, it's going to destroy a whole unique, the whole separate, unique living human being. So, and this is based on the scientific knowledge now that this
yes.
is, in fact, a human being. We know
yes.
also much more about how abortion harms women, and that's something Roe v. Wade claimed to help women, but now we know abortion harms women. And Roe v. Wade, you know, said a lot of other things that, you know, oh, well, we don't want to burden the woman with the burden of childbearing. Well, now we have safe haven laws in all the 50 states. A person doesn't feel she can't raise the child. She can safely bring that child to a designated place, whether it's a firehouse or whatever the laws of that state provide. And these safe haven laws let her leave the child there, no questions asked. You won't get in any legal trouble, and someone else will take care of that child. So in other words, this is all to say, look, the circumstances are very different now. The court can certainly reconsider and reverse Roe v. Wade. And what we see happening, of course, now with President Trump and the Republican Senate, more and more pro-life judges are being appointed in the all the federal courts, the district courts, the circuit courts, and, of course, on the Supreme Court as well. I think this is what has the pro-abortion forces very nervous at this point in time.
Wow. What do you think of the Democratic candidates for presidency? You're saying Democrats pretty much are all about the murder and the slaughter of innocent
yeah.
children. So
they are. They're horrible. These people are absolutely. I mean, every single one of these candidates on the Democratic side of the aisle who has declared for their intention to run for president is in favor of all these late term abortions. I mean, the Senate had a vote just the other day, as a matter of fact, on a law that would protect babies after they are born. And all of these Democratic senators that are planning to run for president all voted against that law, all of them. And it's like, what in the world is going on here? You mean to tell me that some people are going to vote for a man or a woman who can't even protect a born baby, and they're going to elect them president of the United States? Absolutely unthinkable.
If there's no hope for the baby, there's no hope for the child. If there's no hope for the child, there's no hope for the adult, and there's no hope for the nation. We've got to
That's
protect
right.
the youngest and the most innocent and the most defenseless of all of us, you know?
Exactly.
Yes.
You know, somebody came up to me on the street one time at one of our pro-life demonstrations, and he said this. He said, Father, these politicians, you know, these pro-abortion politicians, he says, my view is if a politician can't respect the life of a little baby, how's he supposed to respect mine?
Yes.
And that was such a great insight. You
yes,
know? It's
absolutely.
So true.
Yes. And, you know, I don't know, but well, let me ask you this, because you know somebody's, what do you think that pro-lifers could do right now? What can I do to help ensure a pro-life victory? I want to be an activist. I pray and pray and pray, and I try to even do more. Mm-hmm. I've actually marched in the, you know, Washington, D.C. thing, and I've marched down yeah. streets in Syracuse, and I donate when I can, as much as I can, but what else can I do?
Yeah.
I want to do more.
Yes. Well, let me give my website again, endabortion.us. And I mention that because we have an action box right on that website, endabortion.us. For example, people can take the descriptions of abortion and spread them to others, show them the diagrams, because people are arguing about abortion and they've never seen it, or they've never heard a description of it, or they've never heard how it's done. And we found that that's the most powerful thing to help people wake up. We also have our Silent No More campaign. People can look look at the testimonies of those that have had abortions, have been harmed by it, and their voices are among the most powerful. People can get guidance on our website about how to write to their legislators or give a call to their senators. We give them exactly the messages to convey at the times that they need to convey them, like where there was this recent vote. We sent out an action alert that said to people, call this number. Here's what you tell your senators. People can sign up and receive those action alerts at our website. These are just some of the things. And people can start to get ready for the elections of next year. If we want the right kinds of laws, we have to elect the right kinds of lawmakers. And
yes.
So now is the time to get ready for that. Register people to vote. Talk about it. Spread the word. So we give you messages to spread. We give you information to share, testimonies to broadcast to others. Again, endabortion.us. There's something there for everyone, and we want to get everybody involved.
Some of our listeners may be listening on a cell phone in the car, and they don't have a pencil, but I want them to know that within a week, this program will be posted on boldbravemedia.com in the archives. So go to the website and go to the archives, and you can hear Father repeat all of this important information. You can actually even take the link and email it to family and friends and other people. We want to get this information out to the world. So those are some great ideas, Father. Believe it or not, I'm looking at my watch, and I'll tell you, time is flying with you, my friend. We're going to take a break now. I'm Dr. Hilaire Taverner. You're listening to Dr. T, PhD, on BBM Global Network. Join us. Come back. We still have some important things to share.
There are artists, and then there's Alice Asmar. This award-winning artist has spent her entire life devoted to her artistic pursuits and has had a lifelong fascination with American Indians of the southwestern United States. Her book, Dance to the Great Spirit, showcases her drawings and paintings inspired by sacred rituals of the Pueblo Indians, and four of her lithographs are in permanent collection at the National Museum of American History and the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. She is one of four artists in the United States to win a Woolley Fellowship for study in Paris at L'École des Beaux-Arts and has been featured in numerous publications. She's exhibited at the world's most prestigious museums and galleries and recently won a 20-year service award from the Burbank City Council and the inaugural art competition of the Foundation of the United States in Paris.
Visit www.asmarart.com, www.aliceasmarinternational.com, and email Alice@aliceasmar@aol.com.
Are you looking for employment and live in Los Angeles, Orange, Riverside, and San Bernardino counties? Jobs Annex is the place for you. Are you an employer looking to fill a position or quite a few positions in Los Angeles, Orange, Riverside, and San Bernardino counties? Jobs Annex is for you. Employers, JobsAnnex.com is your resource for career-minded people. JobsAnnex.com is the convenient place for job seekers and employers to hook up and move forward. Jobs Annex has been serving Los Angeles, Orange, Riverside, and San Bernardino counties for over 14 years. Jobs Annex is a former employment search firm. We've evaluated many thousands of resumes, and we understand what employers want and what job applicants need to be successful in their interviews. At Jobs Annex, we provide you with the tools to tell your story for free. Our resources at JobsAnnex.com will help each applicant construct an award-winning resume, an eye-catching cover letter, and key interview questions to ask in various types of interviews. Best of all, it's free. JobsAnnex.com. That's JobsAnnex.com.
Welcome back, everyone. We're so grateful that you're still with us. I'm Dr. Hilaire Taverner. You're listening to Father Frank Pavone talking about something he has devoted his life to, and that is the protection of the unborn. Father Frank, just before our break, like I say, this time is flying so much, so fast. I asked you, what can churches or what can the clergy do? I will say this. I'm very proud of my St. Anthony of Padua Church because our priests bring up abortion and talk about it from the pulpit. And I'm so proud when they do. You know, I want to stand up and clap, but of course, then everybody would notice me, and I don't want to do that. But what do you think, you know, it's embarrassing, but, you know, what can churches do and clergy? Tell us what you think, please.
Yes, and this is a big part of our ministry. First of all, they do need to preach, and we have resources for the clergy. Preachingonabortion.com is one of our key websites. I've written a book about preaching on abortion that takes all the Sunday readings and week by week shows the preacher how he can preach on that topic. That's one key thing. They have to lead in prayer, and we've got prolifeprayers.com as a website for prayers. We have prayers for every Sunday of the year. If a pastor wants to use them, they're interdenominational, and that can go a long way. And then, of course, the church needs to activate its people. So, for example, why doesn't the church put on the bulletin, on the church website, and hand out to the parishioners a simple phone number and website where people can find alternatives to abortion? For example, there's a website called pregnancycenters.org, and no matter where someone lives, they can go there, put their zip code in, and find the closest pregnancy center, which provides counseling and assistance to a young mom that might be scared because of an unexpected pregnancy, or a young dad who might be tempted to bring her to an abortion clinic. And instead, they'll give them alternatives. They'll counsel them. They'll help them. Pregnancycenters.org, and there's a telephone number there that goes with it, and churches should be heralding this because it's good news, and they can equip their people, and they can say to their parishioners, we want you all to memorize this website and these phone numbers, and so that when you hear of someone who's pregnant and in need, you can literally save a life by speaking up and giving them this information. So those are some of the key simple things. Let me give you another website. There's a lot of different websites here I'm talking about, but prolife.church is a website on which we put these resources for the churches, prolife.church. And it's, again, the preaching, the praying, and then the mobilizing of the people. When it comes to elections, the church should be registering voters and telling people the positions of the candidates. That's perfectly legal for churches to do, and it's perfectly appropriate, and it's so needed in our time when you've got some of these candidates, like we said before, actually in favor of killing babies, not only before birth, but even after birth. It's just totally horrific, and the churches need to be alerting their congregations to this.
You know, Father, I think the world of my pastor, and he's such an inspiration to me. If I wanted to buy this book for him as a gift, or how do I get it again?
The specific name of the book is Proclaiming the Message of Life. And that's also the website, proclaimingthemessageoflife.com is where you can order my book. It talks about why and how we preach on abortion. And then, like I said, it gives commentary on all the Sunday readings. So proclaimingthemessageoflife.com.
Fantastic. And you know, Father, I'm going to just bring up something that I think is very important. We had a program called Holy Love Ministries. There's a visionary in my neighborhood about 15 miles away in North Ridgeville. And for 34 years, she's been seeing the Blessed Mother, Christ, angels, and saints. And I believe her completely because I've seen the sun spinning in the sky over there. I've seen it pulsating. On Divine Mercy Sunday, I saw it, the sun turned burgundy, and so many of us did, thousands, hundreds of us did. I mean, I'm over there praying, and there's 10,000 people there, and we're all praying for an end to abortion, and we're using your mysteries of the rosary. And when I noticed that, you know, that you wrote these mysteries, and it's so inspirational. I use them every Sunday at church when I lead the rosary before Mass, and I use them on the first Saturday of every month. For 3 years now, we have a group of all different parishes come and join us in the Eucharistic Chapel, and we pray to end to abortion. And your mysteries are so, I say, spot on. They're so perfect. They speak the truth. They inspire. They educate. And, you know, God must have helped you to write those mysteries, the joyful, the sorrowful, the luminous, all of them. And I have this opportunity to thank you from the bottom of my heart that I have those prayers that I can pray on a daily schedule. You know, the Blessed Mother told us or asked us at Lourdes to please pray the daily rosary. And I'm constantly praying the rosary of the unborn. And when the visionary first saw the Blessed Mother, she had a rosary, but it had 50 states on it. And that's what she saw when she saw the Blessed Mother for about 20 years. It was only 21 years ago that the 50 states had turned into the blue tear with the baby inside and the blood red cross that separates the decades. So I just wanted to share that with you and thank you for your mysteries. And I also want to ask, what do you think is going to happen if our side loses? I mean, what's the prognosis, Father?
Well, you know, John Paul II, St. John Paul II, wrote about this in his beautiful encyclical, The Gospel of Life, that I would encourage our listeners to reread. And he said that when a state legalizes abortion, the disintegration of the state itself has begun. That's also his exact words. So it's not just about one issue, one policy, one court decision. You know, people say, oh, well, you know, maybe we made a mistake on that, but, you know, we got to pay attention to other issues. No. The disintegration of the state itself has begun. This means that you can no longer have a civilization. You can no longer have a nation. He said it becomes a tyrant state. Again, those are the Pope's words, John Paul II's words. It becomes a tyrant state when you legalize this. So everything falls apart is what happens if our – here's the bottom line. It's not a matter of either pro-choice wins or pro-life wins. The fact of the matter is either pro-life wins or nobody wins.
Yes. You know, I met Pope John Paul II in Puerto Rico, and it was such a privilege to have met. Yeah, it was a privilege. Also, go to holylove.org to learn more about Holy Love, and also go to rosaryoftheunborn.com to buy your own copy of this, your rosary with the book and Father Pavone's beautiful mysteries in it. We've got to take a break, everyone. Don't go away. We still have to finish our thoughts. Love you. God bless you all.
Introducing Better Home BetterHomeAndGarden.com. That's www.betterhomeandgarden.com with just the letter N in Better Home and Garden. BetterHomeAndGarden.com offers you the highest quality products on the market that are environmentally safe and effective, and to make them available to you at the lowest possible prices. BetterHomeAndGarden.com understands that kind of creativity and do-it-yourself attitude. Thus, we developed our website, BetterHomeAndGarden.com. BetterHomeAndGarden.com offers you the following products right online. Bath, bedding, collectibles, craft, sewing and hobby, food and beverage, furniture, home decor, kitchen and dining, lamps and lighting, large appliances, musical instruments, outdoor cooking, patio items, pet supplies, plant and garden, rug and floor covering, small appliances, travel and luggage, and so much more. Better Home and Garden is an online retailer offering a wide variety of high-quality brand-name merchandise at discount prices. Our service is personal and we aim to please. Visit us at www.betterhomeandgarden.com. Make your home your own.
Welcome back, everyone. We're so grateful that you're still with us. I'm Dr. Hilaire Tavener. You're listening to Dr. T, PhD, on BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. We have a fantastic program tonight, a really, really important program. Father Frank Pavone is really educating all of us and honestly inspiring me to fire up and do even more than I've been doing. Father Frank, I'd like to give you more or less the microphone, like some closing thoughts. What do you want to tell us that we should never forget? What do we need to know?
Well, Dr. T, thank you. Thank you so much for this opportunity. It's been a great time speaking with you and with your audience. And I hope that we make a lot of new friends as a result of this broadcast. That's always what I hope, is that people will come connect with us at endabortion.us with Priests for Life, and that we have an ongoing relationship so that we can really all work together. And working together to end abortion, let's remember this. We're never going to build a world that welcomes immigrants across the border if we can't welcome children across the border of the womb, or that feeds the hungry if we can't even feed our own children, or that doesn't kill the guilty by capital punishment if we haven't even learned not to kill the innocent, or that maintains peace between nations if we can't maintain peace between a mother and her own unborn child. The bottom line is that we've got to get this right in order to get all these other issues right, and protecting the unborn has become the number one moral priority, the number one urgency, both for the church and for the state. There's no more basic obligation of government than the protection of life. And my friends, the election season of next year has actually begun already. We've got to think right now about voting and voting pro-life and understanding the very purpose of government, which is the protection of life, not its destruction. So we want to work with everybody in that regard. And as we do so, we work from the point of view of faith to realize that we're not just working for victory, we are working from victory. In other words, the victory of life has already been won by Jesus Christ. He is risen from the dead. He has conquered the entire kingdom of death. And that's our starting point. And so the battle is very real, and these children in the womb are being killed, and their moms and dads are being harmed, and their families are being devastated. But the reality is that we know how this ends. It ends with victory, and because we have the power of that victory, we don't have to wonder whether or not abortion will end. We know that we will be victorious, and therefore we stand in front of all of these terrible things and we say, you no longer have authority over the human family. You no longer have power. Christ is risen, and we're going to proclaim and celebrate and serve that victory. So shall we pray together, and
Father,
we'll give everyone
yes.
a blessing.
Yes, Father, thank
Lord,
you.
We ask your blessing tonight on the children in the womb. Give them your protection. We ask your blessing on our nation and its leaders. Give our lawmakers wisdom and courage to protect these children. And finally, Lord, we want to pray tonight for all those who might be hurting because of their involvement in abortion. We want them to know that we who reject abortion do not ever reject those who have had abortions. No, we want to reach them with the mercy, the forgiveness, the healing of Jesus Christ. We are not against them. We are on their side, whether they've had one or two or 10 or 20 abortions. Lord, we want them to find peace, your forgiveness. And so we ask your blessing upon them and upon us all in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I can never thank you enough, Father Pavone. You've inspired my soul, and you've helped all of us. May God continue to help you in your powerful ministry. And God bless you. I thank you. God bless everyone. Thank you for listening to us. God bless. Goodbye, everyone.
I can feel your presence, I can feel your loving power in the gift of this communion, in this holy hour. Jesus, will you heal me of my iniquity? This I ask of you, 'cause I believe. I believe. I believe in you.
Tune in next week for more thought-provoking conversation with Dr. Hilaire Taverner on Dr. T, PhD.
And I can feel the Holy Spirit now, 'cause I believe.
You've been listening to the BBM Global Network. The ideas, views, and opinions of this broadcast are those of the participants of the program and are not necessarily the ideas, views, and opinions of the BBM Global Network Company.